Good morning, cadets. Yesterday we have learned about periodic functions, right? Any function which is a cosine function with respect to time t or a sine function of time t is a periodic function. Not only that, from the Fourier statement, Fourier analysis, Fourier statement, any sine function or cosine function or even superimposed cosine and sine function, superposition of sine and cosine function with respect to time t having different time periods also represents a periodic function. Now it's very essential to learn about the periodic function so that we are going to learn what is known as simple harmonic motion. Okay, before learning simple harmonic motion, which is one of the simplest form of periodic motion, simple harmonic motion, we are first solving some of the examples regarding periodic functions. Let us solve this example. Which of the following functions of time represents a periodic and a non-periodic motion? There are four functions here. Sin omega t plus cos omega t. Second one, sin omega t plus cos omega t plus sin 4 omega t. Third one, e raised to minus omega t. Fourth one, logarithm function, log of omega t. These are the four examples. Out of these four examples, you have to identify which are representing periodic motion and which are representing non-periodic motion. And if they are periodic motion, find the period for each case, in case if it is a periodic motion. And here, omega is any positive constant. This is the given thing. So, first we will start with the example number 1. Let f of t, any function of time t, represent sin omega t plus cos omega t. One by one, we will solve and check whether it is periodic or not. Sin omega t plus cos omega t can also be written as 1 into sin omega t plus 1 into cos omega t. Right? Anything multiplied by 1 is giving the same number, 1 into cos omega t. So that now I can find out the combination of sine and cosine in the form of a sine function. Here it is of the form a sin omega t plus b cos omega t, where a and b are the constants, and from this equation a is equal to 1, b is also equal to 1. Therefore, this is the standard form, a and b are constants. Therefore, a is equal to 1 and b is equal to 1. Now, if you recall what we have learned yesterday, we have assumed a is equal to d cos phi and b is equal to d sin phi. Here, a is equal to d cos phi and b is equal to d sin phi. So that we can find the value of d. A is 1, b is 1. This implies a is 1. Therefore, 1 is equal to d cos phi and 1 is also equal to b sin phi. Squaring and adding LHS and squaring and adding RHS. 1 square plus 1 square becomes 1 square plus 1 square, 1 plus 1, 2 equal to square root of d cos phi becomes d square cos phi and square root of this one. square sin square phi. So what I have done here, I have done the process of squaring and adding these two equations, LHS with LHS, RHS with RHS. So this equation has v square, you will get cos square phi plus sin square phi. So cos square phi plus sin square phi gives us 1. Therefore, 2 is equal to d square. This implies d is equal to 2. D is equal to 2. Now similarly, if you take d sin phi by d cos phi, d sin phi by d cos phi, we get dd cancels tan phi. Tan phi is equal to, what is d cos phi? D cos phi is 1. And what is d sin phi? D sin phi is also 1. So this is 1 by 1. So therefore, tan phi is equal to 1. So tan of a particular angle is 1. That is nothing but tan 45. Therefore, phi is equal to 45 degree. So in terms of radians, it is pi by 4 radians. Thus f of t which is a sin omega t plus b cos omega t. Yesterday we got the result, recall that result. We got as d sin omega t plus phi. After simplification, we got this result using the trigonometrical identity. So just substitute the value of d and substitute the value of phi, you get the result. Therefore, f of t is equal to d is root 2. And phi is pi by 4. So thus we get f of t equal to square root of 2 sin omega t plus pi by 4. Now I told you how to find whether it is a periodic or non-periodic. We have proved any sine function as a periodic yesterday. So we can check whether it is periodic or not. So we should get the same result when we add time period t to this small t. So here time period t. T becomes equal to 2 pi by omega. How is it 2 pi by omega? I have discussed with you. Suppose I have taken only this sine function. Right? So I just saw here square root of 2 sine omega t. Plus capital T, omega T plus capital T plus pi by 4. So if I get the value of T such that I should get the same result f of T. So in order to get the same result, this T should be 2 pi. Square root of 2 as this sine omega t plus 2 pi. So if you add 2 pi, you will get the same result. 2 pi means 360 degree. In the argument, any angle theta plus 2 pi, you will get the same angle theta. So t plus 2 pi plus pi by 4 as this. So if you just work it out, sin of omega plus it should be 2 pi by omega, so that omega t plus 2 pi omega t plus pi by 4. So thus I proved, therefore we get, therefore t is equal to 2 pi by omega. Therefore first function is periodic. So first function is periodic, therefore this given function is periodic function. Periodic in time t. So we got the periodic time t as t equal to 2 pi by omega. Okay. Now let us see the second example. Now you see the second example. Sin omega t plus cos 2 omega t plus sin 4 omega t. Let it be a sum function of time t, f of t equal to sin omega t plus cos 2 omega t plus sin 4 omega t. Okay. Now, according to Fourier's statement, if you recall, any periodic function which is superposition of sine and cosine functions with different time periods also represent a periodic function. So definitely, you see, this is sin omega t, cos double function, cos 2 omega t, and sin 4 omega t. So sin omega t has a time period, let us say t naught. Cos 2 omega t will be having time period t naught by 2, and sin 4 omega t will be having time period t naught by 4, let us say t naught. So the minimum time period here will be t naught. Therefore this represents a periodic function, since it is a superposition of sine and cosine functions of different time periods. Therefore it represents a periodic function. So let us find out the time period of sin omega t, time period of cos 2 omega t, and time period of sin 4 omega t separately. Sin omega t equal to find the time period of sin omega t, we'll carry out the same procedure. Sin omega t, we get the same value of sin omega t if we add 2 pi. I think you understand this. If we add 2 pi to this argument omega t, we get again sin omega t. Sin omega t plus 360 gives us sin omega t, right? So thus it is a periodic function. Now I will find out the time period t. This can be further written as sin, take out omega, then this becomes t plus 2 pi by omega. So when you take out omega, it becomes t plus 2 pi by omega. So this is of the form sin omega into t plus t naught. Let me take this one as t naught, where t naught equal to 2 pi by omega. So this is time period. Therefore, t naught equal to 2 pi by omega is the time period of function sin omega t. So this is first term, right? Now let us see the second term, cos 2 omega t. We will analyze in the same manner. This is mathematics, trigonometry which you have learned. Cos 2 omega t can be written as
cos 2 omega t plus 2 pi. So that cos 2 omega t plus 2 pi, I get the same result, cos 2 omega t. Because cos 2 omega t plus 360 gives us same cos 2 omega t. Right? Thus, I will be able to get the time period of this function for which it is periodic. Right? Periodic time period I will be able to get. So, take out 2 omega out. So, 2 omega into t plus 2 pi by 2 omega. So, t plus 2 pi by t omega. Since I have taken here t naught, I will take different notation here because it is of different time period now. Therefore, I can write it as cos 2 omega t plus, let me take this one as t dash, t plus t dash, where I got t dash equal to 2 pi by 2 omega, 2 pi by 2 omega. In comparison with the above one, is it not t naught by 2? 2 pi by omega is t naught. So 2 pi by omega divided by 2. Therefore, t dash is equal to 2 pi by t by t naught by 2. It becomes t naught by 2. So its time period is half of the first one. So 2 times the time period of this one represents time period of first function. So it is nothing but, that is, this implies 2 times t dash is equal to t naught. So it is a double function. Now let us see the third one, sine 4 omega t. Sine 4 omega t means cos 2 omega t is periodic with respect to time t, where its time period is t naught equal to 2 pi by omega. So therefore it is periodic function, periodic, where its time period t dash is equal to pi by omega. 2 pi by 2 omega is nothing but pi by omega, which is equal to t naught by 2. Right? Now find out this one, sine 4 omega t. Last one, sine 4 omega t. Same way we will proceed. Sine 4 omega t can be analyzed as sine 4 omega t plus 2 pi. So that we will get the same result, sine 4 omega t. Therefore, sine 4 omega t goes. So it becomes t plus 2 pi divided by 4 omega, 2 pi by 4 omega. Therefore, that can be written as sine 4 omega into t plus, this I will write as some other function, t double dash, where time period t double dash is equal to 2 pi by 4 omega. No need to cancel here 2 ones are 2 twos are, because we know 2 pi by omega is t naught. Already we know this. So thus, with respect to time period of the first function, it becomes t naught by 4. T naught by 4. Therefore, the time period of this one, therefore, this is also periodic with time period t double dash is equal to 2 pi by 4 omega, that is equal to t naught by 4. Thus, in terms of first time period, we write, therefore, t naught is equal to 4 times t double dash. T naught is equal to 4 times t double dash. Here t naught is equal to t naught is equal to 2 times t dash. Here it is t naught equal to 4 times double t dash, t double dash.
So what does it mean? When we have the superposition of a sine function, cosine double function, and a sine 4 function, 4 times the function, then also we get a periodic function with the smallest time period, with the smallest time period equal to t naught 2 pi by omega. Therefore, this entire equation, second equation, represents periodic function. Therefore, equation is also periodic with time t, periodic in time t, periodic in time t, with minimum time period t not equal to, with minimum time period t not equal to 2 pi by omega. Therefore, as it is stated by Fourier, even the combination of sine and cosine functions with different time periods also represents a periodic function with a fixed time period. Okay. Now let us see the third one. The third one is an exponential function, and the fourth one is logarithmic function. Okay. Let us see the third and fourth one. Let us take the third function as some function f of t e raised to minus omega t. It is called as exponential function. And the fourth one is f of t equal to logarithm of omega t. So both are functions of time t, right? Now this is definitely not a periodic function, because it will not repeat. Will not be able to get the same value after a fixed interval of time. Therefore, it is non-periodic. It is non-periodic because as t tends to infinity, as t increases from 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on, if t is equal to 0, we get 1, we get 1. So this can be also written as 1 upon e raised to omega t, 1 upon e raised to omega t. E raised to 0 is 1. So if t is equal to 0, then we get 1. So as t increases from 0 to positive values up to infinity, then what happens? F of t tends to 0. F of t means this value, as t becomes infinity, e raised to infinity becomes infinity in the denominator. If it is infinity in the denominator, then it becomes 0. So if you draw the graph of our exponential function, you see as t is taken along x axis and e raised to minus omega t is taken along y axis, then it tends to decrease from value 1 to infinity. At infinity, it's going to become 0. So this is not repetitive at all. Therefore, it is non-repetitive. And decreasing as time t increases. As time t decreases, monotonically decreasing as time t decreases. As t tends to infinity, f of t, this function, exponential function, tends to 0. Therefore, it is a non-repetitive function, non-periodic function. So there is no time period for this function. Similarly, let us see law of omega t. So this is also non-periodic, non-periodic function of time t. Non-periodic function of time t, because if you draw the graph here, the graph is going to be a divergent graph. It's going to diverge like this. So this type of graphs you are learning, I think, in 12th class.
mathematics. So this is the graph of a logarithmic function, divergent graph. So as therefore as t tends to infinity, log omega t also tends to infinity. So this is increasing. Therefore, log omega t increases monotonically as time increases. Log omega t increases as time increases. So we get a divergent graph. This is time and this is log of omega t. So thus we get a divergent graph. This type of graphs you are learning in the 12th class. Therefore, it is a non-periodic function and it doesn't have any time period at all. Therefore, only it is a sine function or cosine function of time t, or combination of sine and cosine functions of time t, even with different time periods or same time periods, represent the periodic function of time t. So if it is a periodic function of time t, it will have a fixed time period. Okay, exactly at that fixed time period the motion repeats. Okay, now we are going to learn the simplest form of periodic motion, that is called as simple harmonic motion. Simplest form of periodic oscillation, that is what we called as simple harmonic motion. What is a simple harmonic motion? I can give you example of a pendulum clock or a oscillating simple pendulum for small displacements. Oscillating simple pendulum for a small displacement represents a simple harmonic motion. Second example is the motion of a spring attached with a load. The oscillation of a spring attached with a load on a horizontal smooth surface. So it undergoes to and fro motion continuously. We neglect the resistive and dissipative forces. We neglect the air resistance and we neglect the frictional forces, which are dissipative forces. When we neglect dissipative forces and air resistance, then we study the simplest form of periodic oscillation, that is called as simple harmonic motion. In such case of simple harmonic motion, there will be always a force we call it as restoring force. The restoring force is such that it always opposes the displacement. It is always directly proportional to negative of the displacement. And such an oscillation wherein a restoring force acting on an oscillating body is directly proportional to negative of the displacement of the oscillating body, then such a motion is called as simple harmonic motion. Let us study simple harmonic motion in detail. Simple harmonic motion, in short, we write it as SHM. It is the simplest form of an oscillatory motion. So this simple harmonic motion arises due to the fact that there always acts a force which is directly proportional to the displacement of the body which is undergoing oscillation. It is directly proportional to the displacement of the body undergoing the oscillation, and it is always acting towards the mean position. It is always acting towards the mean position. Such a motion is called as simple harmonic motion. Consider an example of the simple pendulum. Suppose this is the mean position of a simple pendulum. This is how we represent schematically mean position. If we just take it to one extreme end, suppose I have taken to one extreme end, right extreme end, and release it, then what happens? This pendulum comes to the mean position, but it will not stop. because of the momentum it has gained, it goes to the other extreme end, and then from here it stops momentarily, and again it comes back to the mean position, and again it will not stop at the mean position. It goes to the other extreme end. In this way, it completes one oscillation. But again, it repeats, comes back to the mean position, goes back to the left extreme position, and again it repeats. Such an oscillation is going to be termed as a simple harmonic oscillation or simple harmonic motion. Here in this case, there acts a force. A force is acting, which is always acting towards the mean position. This force, which is acting mean position, so that its tendency is to bring back the oscillating pendulum to the equilibrium position or to the mean position. And greater the displacement of the pendulum, greater the displacement of the bob of the pendulum, more is the restoring force. So this force here, which is acting towards the mean position, is called as restoring force. More is the restoring force. Lesser the displacement, less is the restoring force. So any oscillation where in there is a force which tends to bring the oscillating body to the mean position or restoring position, and such that the force is directly proportional to the negative of the displacement, which opposes the oscillation, that is the meaning of negative of the displacement, such a motion is called as the simple harmonic motion. Now this is one example of oscillating pendulum. Another example we have been discussing, suppose there is a spring attached with a load taken on a smooth horizontal surface. When this spring is at rest, we take this position as origin and we call it as mean position, or we call it as equilibrium position. When the spring is stretched, if it is elongated, suppose it is stretched up to here and released, let us call this maximum displacement as XM, M for maximum displacement. When it is stretched and released from this position, X equal to XM, then what happens? The block which is stretched, the stretched spring, because of its force, spring force, what we call as spring force, acts on this block and the block starts moving back. But once it comes to the mean position, it will not stop because of the kinetic energy that it has gained, because of maximum velocity that it has gained here, because of momentum. It goes to the other extreme end, right? It goes to the other extreme end, that is minus XM, and then momentarily it stops, and then again it returns back. In doing so, you see, if this is the maximum point and this is the minimum point with respect to origin or equilibrium position, it always oscillates between maximum points to and fro. Such a to and fro motion of a spring attached with a load about the equilibrium position is called a simple harmonic motion, because here also there is a spring force which doesn't allow the block to move freely. There arises a restoring force which tends to bring this block to the equilibrium position. Whenever there is such a restoring force which is always acting on an oscillating body, tending to bring it back to the equilibrium position or mean position, and that force is directly proportional to the displacement, such a motion is called as simple harmonic motion. Now we can define what is simple harmonic motion. The motion in which the force acting on the body, force acting on the oscillating body, we term it as restoring force. Force acting on the body is directly proportional to the displacement and tending to act directly proportional to displacement and acting towards the mean position. It is always acting towards the mean position. See, when it is stretched here, the restoring force acts towards the mean position. When it is compressed here, the restoring force changes its direction, it acts towards the mean position. And the displacement and acting towards the tending to act in this writing sort. Always acting towards the mean position. Such an oscillation is called simple harmonic motion. Simple harmonic motion. So, in short, mathematically, restoring force must be always acting. The restoring force in the second case is the spring force. Here is the restoring force acting on the pendulum. So, restoring force F must be such that it is negative of the displacement . It is not directly proportional to displacement, but it is always tending to bring it back to the mean position. Therefore, it is directly proportional to negative of the displacement. Such an oscillation, if it valids, if this condition is valid for such an oscillation or such a motion, then it is called as simple harmonic motion. Now, simple harmonic motion is definitely a periodic motion. It is periodic with respect to time t. Here in this case, the displacement function is angular displacement with a t, and in this case, the displacement function is x with respect to time t. So, for this case, f is directly proportional to negative of displacement function, linear displacement function x of t, and here this f is directly proportional to negative of angular displacement. So such a condition, when it holds good, then such oscillations are called as simple harmonic oscillations or simple harmonic motion. So it is definitely a periodic function of time t, which we have already learned. So the displacement of any simple harmonic motion can be represented as the displacement of a simple harmonic motion is represented as either sine function or cosine function. We will take it as a cosine function. X, as we have taken here, x as a function of time t must be equal to a cos omega t plus phi, where x function of time t is a displacement function, as you know, displacement of simple harmonic motion, and we know omega, it is angular frequency, such that omega is equal to 2 pi by t, where t is the time period, and here this phi is called as phase constant. Phi is called as phase constant or initial phase. Phase constant, or it is also called as initial phase. And A is called as amplitude.
maximum displacement. Maximum displacement, that is called as MDP. Right? So, in the next video, we will learn about simple harmonic motion and how is it periodic, we will be able to learn it, how it is repetitive and it will take the same value, that is xt as a cos omega t plus pi. We will learn it tomorrow mathematically and we will understand simple harmonic motion in detail. Thank you. Have a nice day.